Penguin Audio presents Command and Control, Nuclear Weapons, the Damascus Accident, and the Illusion of Safety by Eric Schlosser. Read for you by Scott Brick. Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. Leonard Cohen. For my father. Author's note. This is a book about the effort to control nuclear weapons, to ensure that one doesn't go off by accident, by mistake, or by any other unauthorized means. The emphasis in these pages isn't on the high-level diplomacy behind arms control treaties. It's on the operating systems and the mindset that have guided the management of America's nuclear arsenal for almost 70 years. The history of similar efforts in the Soviet Union is largely absent here. Although no less important, such a history requires a knowledge of Russian archives and sources that I lack. Command and Control explores the precarious balance between the need for nuclear weapons safety and the need to defend the United States from attack. It looks at the attempts by American scientists, policymakers, and military officers to reconcile those two demands, from the dawn of the nuclear age until the end of the Cold War. And through the story of a long-forgotten accident, it aims to shed light on a larger theme. The mixture of human fallibility and technological complexity that can lead to disaster. Although most of the events in this book occurred a long time ago, they remain unfortunately relevant. Thousands of nuclear warheads still sit atop missiles belonging to the United States and Russia, ready to be launched at a moment's notice. Hundreds more are possessed by India, China, Pakistan, Israel, North Korea, Great Britain, and France. As of this writing, a nuclear weapon has not destroyed a city since August 1945. But there is no guarantee that such good luck will last. The fall of the Berlin Wall now feels like ancient history. An entire generation has been raised without experiencing the dread and anxiety of the Cold War, a conflict that lasted almost half a century and threatened to annihilate mankind. This book assumes that most of its readers know little about nuclear weapons, their inner workings, or the strategic thinking that justifies their use. I hope readers who were familiar with these subjects will nevertheless learn a new thing or two here. My own ignorance, I now realize, was profound. No great monument has been built to honor those who served during the Cold War, who risked their lives and sometimes lost them in the name of freedom. It was ordinary men and women, not just diplomats and statesmen, who helped to avert a nuclear holocaust. Their courage and their sacrifices should be remembered. Part 1. The Titan. Not good. On September 18, 1980, at about 6:30 in the evening, Senior Airman David F. Powell and Airman Jeffrey L. Plum walked into the silo at Launch Complex 3747, a few miles north of Damascus, Arkansas. They were planning to do a routine maintenance procedure on a Titan II missile. They'd spent countless hours underground at complexes like this one, but no matter how many times they entered the silo, the Titan II always looked impressive. It was the largest intercontinental ballistic missile ever built by the United States, 10 feet in diameter and 103 feet tall, roughly the height of a 9-story building. It had an aluminum skin with a matte finish and U.S. Air Force painted in big letters down the side. The nose cone on top of the Titan II was deep black, and inside it sat a W-53 thermonuclear warhead, the most powerful weapon ever carried by an American missile. The warhead had a yield of 9 megatons, about three times the explosive force of all the bombs dropped during the Second World War, including both atomic bombs. Day or night, winter or spring, the silo always felt the same. It was eerily quiet, and mercury vapor lights on the walls bathed the missile in a bright white glow. When you opened the door on a lower level and stepped into the launch duct, the Titan II loomed above you like an immense black-tipped silver bullet, loaded in a concrete gun barrel, primed, cocked, ready to go, and pointed at the sky. The missile was designed to launch within a minute and hit a target as far as 6,000 miles away. In order to do that, the Titan II relied upon a pair of liquid propellants, a rocket fuel and an oxidizer that were hypergolic. The moment they came into contact with each other, they'd instantly and forcefully ignite. The missile had two stages, and inside both of them, an oxidizer tank rested on top of a fuel tank, with pipes leading down to an engine. Stage 1, which extended about 70 feet upward from the bottom of the missile, contained about 85,000 pounds of fuel and 163,000 pounds of oxidizer. Stage 2, the upper section where the warhead sat, was smaller and held about 1/4 of those amounts. If the missile were launched, fuel and oxidizer would flow through the Stage 1 pipes, mix inside the combustion chambers of the engine, catch on fire, emit hot gases, and send almost 500,000 pounds of thrust through the supersonic convergent-divergent nozzles beneath it. Within a few minutes, the Titan II would be 50 miles off the ground. The two propellants were extremely efficient and extremely dangerous. The fuel, aerosene 50, could spontaneously ignite when it came into contact with everyday things like wool, rags, or rust. As a liquid, aerosene 50 was clear and colorless. As a vapor, it reacted with the water and the oxygen in the air and became a whitish cloud with a fishy smell. This fuel vapor could be explosive in proportions as low as 2%. Inhaling it could cause breathing difficulties, a reduced heart rate, vomiting, convulsions, tremors, and death. The fuel was also highly carcinogenic and easily absorbed through the skin. The missile's oxidizer, nitrogen tetroxide, was even more hazardous. Under federal law, it was classified as a poison A, the most deadly category of man-made chemicals. In its liquid form, the oxidizer was a translucent, yellowy-brown. Although not as flammable as the fuel, it could spontaneously ignite if it touched leather, paper, cloth, or wood. And its boiling point was only 70 degrees Fahrenheit. At temperatures any higher, the liquid oxidizer boiled into a reddish-brown vapor that smelled like ammonia. Contact with water turned the vapor into a corrosive acid that could react with the moisture in a person's eyes or skin and cause severe burns. When inhaled, the oxidizer could destroy tissue in the upper respiratory system and the lungs. The damage might not be felt immediately. 6 to 12 hours after being inhaled, the stuff could suddenly cause headaches, dizziness, difficulty breathing, pneumonia, and pulmonary edema, leading to death. Powell and Plum were missile repairmen. They belonged to Propellant Transfer System, PTS, Team A of the 308th Strategic Missile Wing, whose headquarters was about an hour or so away at Little Rock Air Force Base. They'd been called to the site that day because a warning light had signaled that pressure was low in the Stage 2 oxidizer tank. If the pressure fell too low, the oxidizer wouldn't flow smoothly to the engine. A low light could mean a serious problem, a rupture, a leak. But it was far more likely that a slight change in temperature had lowered the pressure inside the tank. Air conditioning units in the silo were supposed to keep the missile cooled to about 60 degrees. If Powell and Plum didn't find any leaks, they'd simply unscrew the cap on the oxidizer tank and add more nitrogen gas. The nitrogen maintained a steady pressure on the liquid inside, pushing downward. It was a simple, mundane task, like putting air in your tires before a long drive. Powell had served on a PTS team for almost 3 years and knew the hazards of the Titan II. During his first visit to a launch complex, an oxidizer leak created a toxic cloud that shut down operations for 3 days. He was 21 years old, a proud hillbilly from rural Kentucky who loved the job and planned to re-enlist at the end of the year. Plum had been with the 308th for just 9 months. He wasn't qualified to do this sort of missile maintenance or to handle these propellants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.